again. So next 15 minutes, I'll walk you through neuro-leadership. Most of you probably, or some of you would have heard about this neuroscience and neuro-leadership. And for some of you, it will be new. Now I'll tell you why neuro-leadership, and you'll be amazed the kind of leverage of value this neuro-leadership brings to your life in terms of enlightenment and coaching. Business is behaviors. Life is behaviors. Relationships are behaviors. You already? Behaviors are thoughts. What you think, the way it shows up in your body language, it shows up in your eye language, it shows up on your face. Very transparently. People can see through people, can't they? They can. So life is behaviors. Behaviors are thoughts. How many of you today, as of now, you are at present, and be honest, are having your thoughts of the past or future while talking to me on this interview? Multiple thoughts, right? So we will get away from these thoughts in a few seconds. Neuro-leadership talks about if you can just generate one thought in a day towards your purpose, undisturbed, with patience, calmness, without medicines. With this spirit, the medicines go away, whether it's your heart medicines or is it your any other medicines. So if you can generate, if I ask you to just generate one thought in a day and stem out, that's basically self-leadership, and stem out all actions of servant leadership from the same thought, is it possible? Your answer will be may not be. We'll see how it is possible. 90% of the world today, they operate into a mindset or through brain, which we call it as survival mindset. I'll tell you which portion of your brain you are being operated by or run by for your thoughts, mood swings, behaviors. So that from today onwards, you don't have any of these issues. So if I ask you to just pick up 24 hours from your last few years of experience, you guys have been great in terms of your academy, business, corporate life, social, family, society. If I ask you to in the last few years, just tell me one 24 hours where you were without anxiety, without anger, without stress, and without fear. Can you give me just 24 hours? When was it last? Was it yesterday? Or was it a few years back? Or are you able to find it or not? Just tell me one 24 hour segment where you have just flown like water. Without anxiety, without stress, without fear, and without anxiousness. Is it hard to find out that day? In last 12 years or 20 years of your life, I'm just requesting you to give me 24 hours of that day. Hasn't happened. So that's why it's a time for us to look at, not outside, inside, what is happening to us. That's where the new leadership gets to. If you are not able to find out 24 hours in your life, from so many years of your life journey, where you are without these anxious, without your spending that day, without being anxious, or without anxiety, without stress, without fear. I think it's time for us, we need to see how what we are doing to ourselves. Alright? So this neuro-leadership focuses on a thought that you can just generate one thought in a day and stem out beautiful actions of servant leadership. How we do it, I'm going to talk about it. But 90% of the world today they are run by brain. Only 10% of the people are into mindfulness and consciousness mode. That's why people in this world are living only 15% of their actual potential. If you can't do something which you probably don't know, there is no problem. But if you can't do something in life where you have potential to do, we are a tragedy, isn't it? If you can't do something for which God designed you, and you have not done it in this lifetime, are we a tragedy and an issue to others? So this is where we will elevate your productivity in life through this little bit glimpses about brain versus mindfulness and how 10% of the people are able to create joy, abundance, and everything they want in life, and 90% of the people are being operated by brain. Before that, we will understand brain first. So when we are in the washroom, we get great ideas. What happens to those those ideas when we come out of the washroom? It gets washed, absolutely yes. So in the washroom, was it your brain active or was it your mindfulness? When I say mindfulness, it's your enlightenment, it's your consciousness. It's easy. In the washroom, when you get great ideas, Was it your mindfulness which was on, or was it your brain? Brain basically is a sphere of senses. We are going to see that. Mindfulness. When you come out of the washroom, you see family moving, you see TV on, you hear mobile ringing. What happens is, brain is a slave of senses. It catches those elements through senses as a stress. Your brain takes the front seat when you come out of the washroom, and mindfulness or consciousness takes a back seat. Moment you enter traffic in your car or in your vehicle, you see somebody biking fast. Again, you take a stress through senses. See these senses. Your brain is a slave of senses. You see somebody biking fast, you plant that stress in your brain. Brain has neurons, that's why it's called neuro-leadership. There is a law, this law is called Hebb's law, H-E-B-B-S, Hebb's law. It says neurons that wire together, they fire together. Our brain has neurons which are wired or connected by blood vessels. If you plug in one stress or anxiety in your neuron by seeing somebody biking fast outside, by the time you go home and your mom serves you the best food, you will say, Mama, I'm not in the mood because I have pain or headache is happening. And your front behaviors are getting impacted with your mom just because you got a stress in your neuron which got multiplied through epsilon. Story doesn't end here. As neurons multiply this stress, these neurons pass this stress to a portion in the brain called amygdala. Amygdala is that portion of the brain which generates flight, fear, freeze, three F's. It basically, you want to fly away from the situation, or you will say, I'm fearful, my heartbeat is growing, or you will freeze, that I don't know what to do, my body is freeze. Amygdala is that portion of the brain which catches your stress, which you got from the senses, pass it on to your portion in the brain called cerebral nucleus, which is somewhere here, the green one. Cerebral nucleus is that portion of the brain which is connected to your body's limbic system. Our body's limbic system is neck, spine, and heart. Happy news or sad news? 90% of the people who are taking BP medicines today are hit by amygdala and cerebral nucleus, and the chemical gets released to the limbic system. People who are having shoulder pain and neck pain, or stress, or coming on medicines. So 90% of the people, we have tagged them as unfortunately survival mindset. Forget about achieving your purpose. Forget about achieving, getting to free mind thinking. It can't happen. Because your productivity is either 15% or 20% or 30%, because your 70% of the brain has got into stress. So it cannot happen. So that's why the free mind thinking is not happening. Migraines are happening. Kids are coming on BP medicines or migraine medicines now. And the reason for that is your amygdala triggers this chemical to your body's limbic system. And that's why I was asking you, tell me 124 hours a minute when you were without anxiety, stress, anxiousness, and you were flown like water. You are not able to find that 24 hours for yourself. So what happens, the story doesn't end here. As you have not appreciated your mom's food, and next day you come to college or your business, you have a guilt again that I was bad yesterday to my parents and my behaviors, or mood swings have happened. You again develop a guilt. Now guilt is positive or negative? It's anxiety, it's stress. So guilt is negative. Again, you plant on your neuron one more guilt, and then have got triggered. The surrounding four neurons trigger a very negative chemical, reaction, your mood swing happens, and you come into the weakness zone, apart from what's happening to your mind, body, soul. So amygdala is that portion of the brain which has hijacked people's behaviors and productivities through stress, that people are not able to come out of it or come out of medicines. So that's where amygdala plays a role. Just understand the brain. So if you see somebody in a car going, that person probably will not look at somebody biking fast. He or she will look at a beautiful thing. The reason is they are diverting their senses to only take beautiful things inside. And once you look at beautiful things, you put that inside, epsilon again triggers, and then joy appears. So only 10% of the people know this formula, that their senses should not go out in the environment. It should be playing with the ecosystem. There is a book called Brain in the Mind by David Rock, who is the founder of Neuro-Leadership Institute. Read that book, How Can You Tame Your Brain? When I say brain, I'm referring to amygdala. So Brain in the Mind tells you, or the spiritual part of it is, if you align your source, which is your God, Guru, with your soul, and then with your mind, body, intellect, senses, and energy, all seven in one direction, you don't need secret or law of attraction books or any horoscope to work with. You can work with the source directly. That's what the Buddhist monks do. That's what CEOs who go to Himalayas and take a sabbatical and they do this Zen training and they come back and lead large organizations. That's what, for example, yoga gurus like Ramdev do. You just need to connect your source to the soul and make sure your amygdala is not functioning and make sure your mind, body, senses, energies in one direction. Your seven chakras right from your root to your crown chakra gets aligned automatically. The energy which flows from you is sunlight, it will be used to heal others. If you know how to align your seven chakras with this power of mind, you are a very different powerful for the world. Because you become, it's also a spiritual power, so you become magnetic, like a sun. You draw energy automatically flows from you. And forget about reasons. It won't. So here is where what happens. As you move on, there is another portion in the brain which is a culprit. And keeps you in survival mindset always. It's called B ganglia. B ganglia is that portion of the brain which has all the conditioning done to you. A, from your neighbors, parents, society, I'm not saying right or wrong. Whatever has been told to you is sitting in B ganglia. So for example, if one of you are with me in a car and you see a 700 story building up, you will say, Ankush, this building will fall. And I'll ask you why. You will say, because 700 story building not possible in India. My uncle's time, one building has fallen. So during uncle's time, he shared his experience with you, which is sitting in big area, and you're taking a judgment. Somebody tells you that don't launch this product in the market as an entrepreneur because it has failed for him or her. And you go with that stress, and you put that conditioning in big area, and you're not able to do free mind thinking. So people who have all this conditioning done in big area, their free mind gets restricted, the brain restricted. You are functioning through the same neural circuits every day. Outcomes can't be different. But you need to break that neural circuit of B ganglia. Right? So the ideal way to do it and make it as a rational mind is you can say that let me research about this builder. When you research about this builder, you have found that this builder has made 800 story buildings in Delhi, Dubai, 1000 story buildings, none has fallen. Now what happened to those that condition? Ratan Tata is famous to research for everybody, right? So he listens to a vendor in the Tata Steel Factory, he listens to a CEO in the boardroom. And ask the vendor, he says to the vendor, how can I improve my vending processes for Tata Steel Factory? And he asks the CEO of the boardroom that what is my next go-to-market model for UK markets? So Ratan Tata listens to everybody but doesn't have a condition. He, what he does is, he actually takes data, not decision from his B ganglia. He listens and accumulates it in B ganglia. So all business leaders who are smart, who are trained into neuro-leadership, what they do is they take data from B ganglia. They never believe it. They ask for more data and they validate and they don't take decision. Unless the decision is there. Are you with me so far? So next time when people have told you that don't go here or this market product will not work, tell that person, give me data. So you can tame this portion of the brain as rational mind rather than conditioning mind. This is a shift, a paradigm shift in your brain. That's where now you are able to now bring your brain to the mind. So if you know how to control your portion, two portions of the brain in terms of your consciousness and soulfulness, you are done for life. One is amygdala, the other one is B ganglia. Now there is a third portion in the brain which has no capacity to generate negative thoughts. In next 1 minute, I'll tell you how to enlighten that portion. That's why it's called enlightened purpose leadership. This portion of the brain which has no capacity to generate negative thoughts is called prefrontal cortex. Fortunately, it coincides with Ajna Chakra between the two eyes, divine eye or the third eye. If you know how to open this third eye, outside and inside, it opens outside and it opens inside also. If you know how to open this third eye, which is Ajna Chakra, you can create the thought you desire with your soul and source working together for you, and your mind, body, intellect, and mind in one direction with that energy, and you can put that thought to the rest as you require. Right? So, prefrontal cortex, as brain needs images, the easy way to enlighten prefrontal cortex is you just imagine a photo of God, Guru, or consciousness. Some people say, I don't believe in God. Then I ask that person, sir or ma'am, do you do wrong things every day? They say, no, we do right things every day. I say, then you don't need to imagine a photo of God, you need to just draw energy. How do you do right things? They say, from my consciousness. I say, then put a photo of your consciousness in front. Why you want to debate God is there or not there? So, with the prefrontal cortex, how you can enlighten this portion through meditation is you connect with the source, and that source should be pure, God, Guru, or consciousness.
It's called self-leadership. Surrender. Draw energy only from you. So it's called self-leadership. Now serve people outside. So in the morning, for example, our stimulus to get negative thoughts is very high. Because your kids are ready to go to the school, you need to go to office or college. In the morning when you wake up, there is a high stimulus that you will get negative thoughts because of the day's transaction waiting for you has put a stress on your mind already. So the first thought you generate in your day will carry you throughout the day. Be very fully conscious about it. So in the morning when you wake up, don't do anything. Don't wait for it to do this thing. Just say good day, God. Or good day, my guru. Or good day. Answer comes back, good day, Ankush. Now you say, God, I am moving with you. The whole day I will draw energy only from you with your blessings. I will only serve outside. Through surrender leadership, self-leadership, all actions from my self-leadership will go as servant leadership in terms of my behaviors towards. You will find your karmic actions will go up. You will find, spiritually, you will get karmic clearances of your old. That's what is told in Shiva Yoga and also in Brahma Kumari's Raja Yoga training or Sahaja Yoga, which we do. It all coincides. So what happens is when you are only able to generate one thought in a day and step out all actions, your calmness can't be buried throughout the day. It's not that we don't know joy. It's not that we don't know happiness. We are not able to stay there, isn't it? And we are not able to scale it up, isn't it? We all know how to create joy. We all know how to create happiness. But how many of you are able to create, stay in that zone and scale it up is the question. With this self-leadership to servant leadership, you will be always in that joyous mode. Now when you see somebody biking fast outside, what you need to do is do not shift the source. Think I'm drawing energy from my source. Watch the beautiful tree and think my source is there and keep your joy always on. Or read a newspaper or listen to the music. If you don't allow your senses to go outside, there is no reason that amygdala can hijack your happiness. So here neuro-leadership and spiritual concerns. Here metaphysics comes. Now, the beauty of it is that people read Secret Law of Attraction but they are not able to have all the seven in one action. Let me ask you a question. What is the difference between meditation and prayer? Anyone? So if I could just summarize it quickly, prayer is when you are speaking God presence. You speak to God, right? Through your mind, through your behavior, through your verbs, words and all. So meditation, prayer is you speak God presence. Meditation is God speaks, you listen. Now my second question to you, and I am now coming to how to find your purpose. Why God designed you for this life? Not only taking care of family, society, but there's a bigger purpose for all of us. My second question is, people who have found their purpose in life, would they have found their purpose in life by prayer or meditation? Now answer is simple. You got the answer. When you connect with the source through meditation, this is another chakra. As you start meditating, it's called still meditation to moving meditation. While I'm talking to you, I'm connected with my source, but I'm only serving you. Right? It's moving meditation. That's the next stage of meditation. After still meditation is moving meditation. So as you connect on still meditation with your purpose, with your source, you will come to know, so you said I mean later or that, well, what was your purpose for which you were designed? And then you can start work, for example, if your purpose is to become a chairman. You can say C equal to GLN and you can put in years of 14, C equal to 14. Put this request to mind manifestations like secret says. You put this C 14 to your soul, your source, connect with the soul, and say that in 14 years I want to be GLN. Break this C 14 to P 14 or P 14 purpose in 14 years to G 14, G 12, G 10, G 4, G 3, G 2, G 1. What is G? Goals. If you are in 14 years you want to be a chairman, your first year goal should be what? Or if you want to be a CEO, your first year G1 goal should be start attending CEO conferences. Isn't it? Your second year goal will be network with some of the CEOs in the conference and say, sir or ma'am, can you mentor me once in 3 months for 15 minutes? But all this you do by working with your source and your consciousness. You don't need after this any horoscope or secret and law of attraction. The reason is your source, your soul, your mind, your body, your intellect, your energy, and seven chakras are aligned to achievement. After that, you know how to stop simulating. And you can do it with full joy. Make sure you are not caught in the world through your senses. If somebody is saying bad words, don't let your ear take it to your brain and amygdala. Pass on and say pass. Tell your mind it is a pass. Somebody saying bad words also, pass it from this ear and pass it from this ear. Do not let it go through your senses to your brain. If you know how to tame your brain in the So with this, you can be as calm as you are in the washroom. Your calmness can't go away if you have controlled these two questions. Now, two things, and after this, I will end this session. Two things in this brain science you need to understand. If something has happened in the past, please do not remember it. Because brain has neuroplasticity. Moment you remember a past incident, perhaps now will trigger again, more neurons will be got into the same thinking. And you will be hold in the past. If you are worrying about the future, please leave that worry aside and work with the source. See, end of the day, people ask me to push fear of unknown. Fear of unknown, and this is replaced by faith of unknown. I asked the vice chancellor at the university when I was doing this session. I said, sir, when was the last time when you had an unknown hit you? Last week. He said, no, Ankush, I'm perfectly fine. Last week I was in college. I said, last month. He said, no, Ankush, no problem. I said, last 6 months. He said, no. I said, last 1 year. He said, no, life perfectly fine, just little bit hiccups. In the last 1 year, this unknown has not hit you. And your whole life is going into what will happen to me, what will happen to me. You should say, whatever happens to me, this is what I will be. I will be always like this. And fear of unknown is replaced by faith of known. Isn't it? Not the blind faith. For example, if we are in the lift and the power goes off in the lift at 800 floor, and I am an NLP practitioner, if the other person doesn't know this brain issue, he's hit by amygdala, then that other person will, he or she will say that I'm feeling fearful because that's very dark. Or I need to bang the lift door and I want to get out. Right? So what happens is people just respond because of this amygdala. But if I am with that person, I will say, hold on, we have three options. One is my mobile signal is coming, I can call somebody in the lift, even if it's dark. Second, lift has a bell. We can press the bell. And the third one is, I can always, I have heard that the lift goes to the ground floor when the power goes off, capacitor releases the doors, and the doors automatically open. In the same situation, one person in life is caught by a middle of life, fear, freeze. I am enjoying and giving three options. Replace this lift situation with life. 10% of the people who have gone through with this man or training, or they know that it's the brain versus mindfulness, they always enjoy life in the same situation, whatever that situation is. Because it's fear is replaced by faith and action. Fear has a chemical generated by your amygdala. Faith is mindfulness and consciousness in God's connection, which is stronger. So even if you have a fear of unknown, have a thought today. One thought can change your mind. That my source will work with me and the protection will be automatically there, that situation will go. That's the only thing you need. One assurance thought to remove your fear of unknown in life. Otherwise, whatever step you take in life will be always a half step. Otherwise, your productivity is only 15% because the mind is caught in stress. So from today, start operating from prefrontal cortex through meditation. Understand still meditation. And only generate one thought in a day that God, I am going to live on a purpose. And we are living fine. Whosoever comes on the way, in the day of me, I will just serve him or her through your energy. You become a hollow container. You are only drawing energy and serving outside. You have nothing inside. It's called nothingness. Once you have nothingness, everything starts changing you because the source starts creating for you. Then you don't need secret law of attraction.